Good morning and welcome to Brisbane Evangelical Church. We meet in the coastal town of Largs in North Ayrshire, and thank you for joining with us this morning. Today is Remembrance Sunday, so the first part of the service will be a short act of remembrance for those who have lost their lives in two world wars and in other conflicts as well. After that, we'll be looking at our theme that we've been examining over the past few weeks, and that is But God, and we'll say more about that later. Meantime, we have a hymn which is appropriate for this occasion. It's a hymn that reminds us of the goodness of God to us in the past, and it reminds us of our hope in him for the future. A hymn by Isaac Watts, O God Our Help in Ages Past.
Thank you.
I had a number of uncles who were in the army during the First World War. None of them returned unscathed, with one being killed and two being wounded. One of these uncles, whilst in the army, had a friendship with a chap from the Isle of Orkney. And both of them had come to the conclusion that the chances of survival were quite low. And having come to that conclusion, they decided to study the scriptures and read the Bible, which they did regularly. And during that time, I think they came to know the Lord. During a battle, my uncle was badly wounded, not by enemy action, but by what they call today friendly fire. One of our own troops went berserk and started shooting into his own people. And so my uncle was quite severely wounded. His friend came to him, insisting in giving him some money that he put in his pocket, and said, "I'll see you later." So my uncle was taken to a field hospital. He was at the bottom of the queue because he wasn't expected to survive, but he did. As he improved in hospital, he sent a returned the letter and the money he had received from his friend back to him, and received the letter back saying that he had been killed in action. That was something that remained with him for the rest of his life. But whilst he was in hospital, my uncle prayed, and prayed regularly to the Lord, and he was worried about the future, worried if he would recover. But one night, he had a dream. It was a very vivid dream, and he felt as if a figure came to his bed and touched him. And in that kind of semi-awakening state, he heard a voice saying, "Fear not, I will be with you." And you know, it said that it brought a sense of calm to him and a sense of peace, for he felt that in truth the Lord was with him. And he recovered and lived a happy life and a fulfilled life from there on in. It makes us wonder, doesn't it though? Why war? Why one person survived and another person died, as my uncle's friend did? And of course, as we go through difficulties and problems as well, perhaps as we lose loved ones, we wonder why that should happen, why that should occur. But in all our situations, we too can hear the voice of the Lord saying to us, "Fear not, I am with you." For the Lord has promised to be with us in all the circumstances of life. Now we see through a glass darkly. We don't actually understand everything that happens to us or why, but we can have this assurance that the Lord is with us. Shall we pray? As this message is being pre-recorded and will be viewed on different days and at different times over the next few days, we're not going to have a 2-minute silence after the prayer, but we will have a few moments of silence to allow you to reflect on perhaps loved ones you have lost during these world wars, to remember the freedoms that we have through their sacrifice, and to pray for peace in our world. Shall we pray? Our God and gracious Heavenly Father, we come into your presence in and by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today in your presence, we remember those who sacrificed their lives in 2 world wars and in other conflicts that have occurred. We also remember those whose health has been impaired by wounds which they suffered. Many are brokenhearted today as they remember comrades, friends, and relatives who lost their lives in conflicts, people who meant so much to them, and people they remember as they were perhaps many years ago. We pray today that people may be comforted by your presence and by your nearness. We thank you for the freedoms that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for the freedoms that these people won for us. And we thank you for the freedom particularly to worship as we can today. And so we come before you to remember those who are mourning today. We pray for our world and we pray for our community. We pray that there might be peace instead of war, that men and women of goodwill might prevail, that good may triumph over evil, that we may be generous rather than greedy, giving rather than taking, and that hatred and bitterness may give way to love in our world, in our community, and in our hearts. We pray for the day when the Lord Jesus Christ will reign supreme, when weapons will be recycled into pruning hooks, when nations shall speak peace unto nation, and when our Lord Jesus Christ will reign supreme. Father, hear our prayer and bless our land and bless our people as we once again remember those who are in mourning today. Lord, be with them. We ask this in our Lord Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Our second hymn gives thanks to the Lord for his goodness in the past. It reminds us of our faith in him in the present and how we look to him for the future. The hymn is called Lord for the Years. Shall we pray? Lord, we come into your presence and we pray that you'll help us to study your word. We pray that you will help us to apply it to our lives as we try to live for you day by day. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. As I mentioned earlier, today we continue in our study based on the words, but God. And today we're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we're reading verses 26 to 32. Paul writes his letter to the church in Corinth. He's writing to remind them of what the Lord had done for them, what they were before they met the Lord. Nevertheless, the Lord has chosen them and given them his strength that can overcome their weakness and help them in serving him. Amen. Paul writes this, "Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become our wisdom from God, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. As it is written, let the one who boasts, boasts in the Lord." A bit of background might be helpful to our understanding of these verses. The Apostle Paul helped to found the church in Corinth round about the year AD 55. Later, while he was in Ephesus, he heard news of the church, news that caused him great concern. In addition to that news, the Christians in Corinth had written a letter to him asking for guidance in some issues that they were facing. So Paul writes to them in the letter that we know as 1 Corinthians. One of the problems was that there were divisions in the church, with people claiming to follow Paul or Apollos, who is another evangelist with Paul, or Peter. Why this was happening isn't quite clear, as these men were united in their preaching of the gospel. So the people in Corinth must have been splitting hairs. In the verses preceding our reading, Paul addresses the influence of worldly wisdom on the church, and later writes of the pride and jealousies that were associated with it. Possibly some of the divisions came from this influence. In addition to these divisions, there were other issues that needed addressing. Whilst the Corinthian believers seemed to have good contacts in the community, Paul's concern is that they were too influenced by the world. They were just a bit too cozy with the systems and ideas around about them for his liking. There was a danger that the church could be torn apart by the influence of religions and some of the practices that existed in Corinth and people's different viewpoint on these. But in the verses we read, Paul says this, "Remember what you were." And he goes on to say, "But don't forget what you now are in Christ." First of all, let's look at remember what you were. Paul says, "Remember what you were when you were called." Most had come from a humble background. They were ordinary people, perhaps some artisans, perhaps some shopkeepers, and no doubt some of them had been slaves or were slaves. There were one or two people in the Corinthian church who were important as far as this world is concerned. For example, Erastus was the director of public works, we read, or perhaps that means the city treasurer. And there was also a believer whose house was used to accommodate the church gatherings, so he must have had quite a large house for people to go to. Remember what you were. In Ephesians, Paul reminds the believers of what they were before they came to the Lord. He says this in Ephesians chapter 2. "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following after its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. Think of what we were. No doubt some in Corinth had lived a good life with a measure of prosperity, but others could look back to dissolute lives, paganism, idolatry, perhaps temple prostitution, drunkenness, for which Corinth was notorious. But no matter their background, they all needed the Lord. They were in darkness, needing the light of salvation. And through their faith and trust in the Lord, they had come into that light. But we can apply that to ourselves. What of us? What were we? We come from a variety of backgrounds. Perhaps there were some of us who were ignorant of the gospel, knew nothing of it. Perhaps we knew it well, but were heedless and careless. Perhaps we were sympathetic to the gospel, but didn't see any need for us to come to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation. Possibly self-righteous, possibly trying our best, but with no thought of what the Lord had done for us or of what we owed him. Possibly having no faith. Perhaps our lives were in a mess. Perhaps we resented and rejected the Lord. But all of us, no matter our background, were outside of Christ, without salvation, and lost. Like the Corinthians, we had nothing to commend us to the Lord, yet God, in his grace, chose them and has chosen us. And so Paul says, think of what you were, and perhaps you need to humble yourself a bit, because some of them were feeling very proud. And there were jealousies among them. We read that elsewhere in the book. So Paul says, think of what you were, but despite that, the Lord has chosen you. The Bible says we have been chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. And what a difference that has made to our lives. Our backgrounds, as I've said, are different. For some, there was hardly any change in lifestyle when they came to know the Lord. But for others, the change in lifestyle was great. All of us, however, can consider what we might have been had we not come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. What blessings we would have missed. What friends we would never have known. What joys we would not have known. We would have never known the hope of the gospel in our hearts. Perhaps doomed to addiction and the misery that it brings, never to have a new life in Christ, never to know salvation or to be with the Lord in eternity. But nevertheless, being chosen by God is difficult for us to understand and hard to take in. And it does prompt another question, doesn't it? Does God choose one person arbitrarily and reject another? That wouldn't sit comfortably with the God of justice that we know. So how can it be? Salvation was once explained to me as being like a door between on one side lostness and death, and on the other side salvation and eternal life. And as we approach this door, we see a sign above it, and we approach it from the side of lostness and darkness. And as we approach it, we see a sign saying, whosoever will may come. If we choose to answer God's call, we pass through the door. And as we look back, we see another sign, saying, chosen in Christ before the foundation of the world. I think the phrase before the foundation of the world is the one that helps us to unravel this mystery. We are in time. We are trapped in time, but God exists both without and within it. He knows the end from the beginning. He knows who will answer his call and who will reject it. We make a choice and a decision in time, but God, who stands outside of time, says that he has chosen us, for he knows the outcome of our decision. I look on it a bit like an old-fashioned film strip. The projectionist can hold it out and can see a series of still frames that can be projected onto the screen to give movement. We can look at one particular frame, let's call it the present, and we can see what's happening there. And we can look back to the previous frames, and we can see what has happened there, and that's the past. But we can also look forward to see what frames have still to come, what's going to happen in the film in the future. God is like that projectionist. God sees then from the beginning. He knows who will respond to his call. He sees the future, he sees the past, he sees the present. But for us in the present, we have a real choice to make as to whether we follow the Lord or not. Paul says we've been chosen. What a privilege that is, that we've come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Although Paul has said not many wise have been chosen by this world's standards, he goes on to say, you have wisdom though. You have wisdom that comes from the Lord. Now, Paul here is not decrying the use of common sense, logic, or the proper application of science. But he is saying that the wisdom of some of the Greek philosophies and the religions in Corinth were foolishness in God's eyes. The dictionary definition of wisdom is having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. I suppose it's about knowing what to do, when to do it, and how to do it. It's about having good goals and discernment about achieving these. But what about spiritual wisdom? I suppose it's the same. The same definition could be applied, but spiritual definition comes from the Lord. First, it begins with the fear of the Lord. That means honouring and respecting him. Proverbs 9 and 10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Secondly, wisdom is received from God's word. Psalm 19, verse 7. The instruction of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord is trustworthy, making the inexperienced wise. The Bible reveals the mind and the will of God, and the more we apply that to our lives, the more spiritual wisdom will mark our walk before people and before God. And thirdly, wisdom, we're told, comes to those who ask for it. James 1, verses 5 and 6 says, now if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives to all generously without criticizing, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith, without doubting. In the difficult situations we face, it's good to ask the Lord for wisdom. James describes two types of wisdom in his book, the wisdom of the world, and he compares this to the wisdom that comes from the Lord. And he says the characteristics of the Lord's wisdom are purity, goodness underpins it. It's peace-loving, considerate, submissive, merciful, impartial, and sincere. The opposite to that is to ferment division and conflict, to be inappropriately proud and haughty, to be unforgiving, ungracious, and unfair, to be inconsiderate to others. Now, if we base our actions on James' definition of wisdom, we will act wisely before God. We will have better lives, better relationships, and if all of us practiced that, we would have better communities in which to live. Paul says, though, the preaching of the cross is foolishness to this world. The Greeks seek after wisdom, he said. They want to think their way to God. And the Jews look for miraculous signs. But Paul writes, we preach Christ crucified. The Greeks were very advanced in their science and philosophy, but they were far from God. Their philosophies are very difficult to understand and are primarily about the individual discovering God through intellect and thought. And it takes some intellect and thought to understand them. Having read one or two of the Greek philosophers, all I can say is it's all Greek to me. By contrast, the message of the gospel is very simple. Though it's difficult to understand why God should show us such love and grace by sending the Lord Jesus into the world. It's a message of wisdom to the Corinthians, and it's a message of wisdom to our age as well. It's not about us discovering an unknown God by our intellect, and so creating a God in our own image. The cross reveals God, a God who loves us, a gracious God, a God who has paid the price of our sins, a God who brings us the wisdom of God in Christ. And Paul says that's righteousness, it's holiness, and it's redemption. Paul says God's wisdom is seen in righteousness, doing what's right, holiness, serving God and making this world a better place, bringing to people to Christ, and redemption, knowing we are right with God and knowing the peace of his forgiveness in our hearts. The cross reveals the nature of God. It reveals our sinfulness and our need for salvation. The resurrection, foolishness to the Greeks, demonstrates the power and the reality of the gospel. Paul says, not many wise were chosen, and yet we have wisdom that comes from the Lord, a spiritual wisdom that he gives to us. Then Paul says, you were weak when you came to the Lord, yet you have strength. Just before the verses we wrote when he told them they were weak, we read in Corinthians 1 and 8, the Lord Jesus will keep you strong to the end. There seems to be a divine principle that God uses the weak and lowly to demonstrate his power and his might. His strength is made perfect in our weakness. Think of Gideon with his small army. And God says to him, it's too big. Cut it down in size. And yet he goes on to defeat a much bigger enemy. The victory is the Lord's. Think of David, the youngest of his brothers, going out to face Goliath without armor, without a sword, but with his trust in the Lord. The victory was the Lord's. Think of the Lord Jesus Christ in his meekness and his humility. A carpenter despised by the religious leaders of his day, yet defeating death, hell and the grave with the seeming defeat and shame of the cross. The victory is the Lord's. Jesus said, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Paul says, you are weak, you're lowly, but God uses such to overcome the strong, to overcome evil. If he asks us to serve, he provides us with the ability and he strengthens us in our weakness. And finally, Paul says, not many noble were chosen, not many important people with position. And yet, read this in Ephesians. Paul writes, God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming age, he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. What a position we have in the Lord. We're in his family, joint heirs with Christ, to spend eternity with him. So, not many wise, not many important, not many noble were chosen. Yet in Christ and through him, all these are ours. What a privilege that is. But at the same time, that privilege should be coupled with humility. For it is not our doing, but the Lord's doing. Although we may feel inadequate at times, the work is the Lord's and the outcome is his. Remember the words of the Lord Jesus Christ to his disciples and through them to us. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel, and lo, I am with you always. And so he is, and we give thanks to the Lord for all that he has done for us. Shall we have a short prayer? Our God and Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you for your goodness and your kindness to us. We give thanks that in ourselves we are weak, but we rely on your strength. And so we give thanks and praise that you can be with us to guide us and to keep us safe, to watch over us and we seek your blessing on all who hear this message and their families as well. Again, we remember those who remember loved ones on this Remembrance Day. And so be with them and be with us all. In Jesus' name, amen. A final hymn is a hymn called Your Perfect Will, which summarizes some of the thoughts we've had today.
Perfect will in your perfect way.